Is everybody ready for the Mad Dog Commander of the Show?
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napa. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. My sponsors tonight are audiobooksnow.com. You know about audiobooksnow.com. Don't make me tell you all about it already. About the convenience of audiobooks, you know about that. I mean, really, in today's world, a busy world, we don't often have time to sit down and find the quiet time to read a book, and audiobooks just helps make that convenient. You can put it on your phone or your iPad or iPod or whatever portable device you have, plug in your earbuds and listen to a book being read to you while you drive, while you go about your work or your chores or whatever. It's a convenience thing. You know about that. They've been around forever. It used to be on cassettes. Remember that when you had a Sony Walkman, you could put a cassette audiobook on cassette, and usually it would buy me about 10 or 20 cassettes to get through an entire book, especially if it was a long book. Those days are happily over, and it's just a simple MP3 you download right now, so that's really convenient. And you know about that, so why am I telling you about all the convenience about it? You know about it, right? Yes, say yes. Yes, dog, we know about it. Well, the difference that sets audiobooksnow.com apart, it's price point. It's just simple as that. You can get audiobooks in lots of places, and I don't want to mention all those other brands and other places where you can get them, but you know where you can find audiobooks. The difference with audiobooksnow.com is price point. Less expensive than just about any other service, Not just about. They're less expensive than any other service. But here's something that makes the deal even better. The link in the description, if you click it, and I mean after the show, not during the show, not now, certainly. The link will be to audiobooksnow.com from the Mind Dog TV account. And with that link, you will get 50% off your first purchase, whether that's a single book or a monthly book club plan or a yearly book club plan. So it's a great deal. And on top of that, even better, you get a 7-day free trial. So all of that, you start with the lowest price point available anywhere. Take 50% off your first purchase of that, and you get a 7-day free trial. You can't beat that. Click the link in the description after the program, and I thank you for patronizing my sponsors. It means a lot to me. I'm torn about where to go with a brief intro. I'm in a very anxious and weird mood tonight. I have a great guest lined up. Got a book. I'm not sure if it's available on audio. I got to ask him about that. Remind me to ask him about that, will you? Okay. Before I do, though, I have a couple of friends who called me up last night and are really upset and angry about this whole Yankees taking a knee to recognize the Black Lives Matter movement. And I don't want to get really involved in the politics of it, and whatever yours are, God bless you. But I just want to explain something about taking a knee and kneeling. Kneeling has been part of man's body language, gestures for as long as mankind has existed. And it's never been something that means disrespect. Never. We do it as a form of honor. We do it as a form of submission. We do it as a form of humility, respect, and being humble. That's it. We do it to pray to God. We do it to ask for a woman's hand. We do it to accept an honor, like being knighted. You kneel for those things. In sports, you take a knee to say, please don't tackle me. I submit. Free catch. You know, that kind of stuff. So it's never, ever, ever been an act of disrespect. And I think people need to understand that and stop with the anger about it. People are making a statement by it, and the statement has nothing to do with disrespect. It has to do with just calling attention to something that they think is really important. So that's all I'm going to say about that. I'm not going to get too worked up over it. I'm not going to get too political about it. And we're going to move on with the program. Speaking of kneeling to God and to talk to God, to pray to God, whatever you do, however you see God, my guest tonight has an interesting take on that. He's a avid film fan, and he's found a way to tie his love for God and Jesus into movies, into film, into popular film. And it's a fascinating book. He's written a book. It's called, what is the actual name of the book? Let me pull it up here. It's Jesus Loves Movies, which might strike some people, you know, devout Christians, just to hearing that name, they might think that it's blasphemy. It's not. Believe me, I've read samplings of the book. I haven't read the book, but it is really a unique way of looking at God in our lives, God in our art, God in everything we do. So I think you're going to be fascinated by this chat. Please, now, I'm going to have to practice what I practiced his name, I think, 10 times before we went on the air. Now I'm getting a little nervous that I'm going to get it wrong. So let me just start by saying, please open your ears and open your minds and help me welcome in the intriguing and interesting Phil Strangolagalli. I'm sorry about that. You know I practiced it.
Yeah,
I apologize for that. How are you, my friend? Thank you for coming.
Great. Yeah, thanks for having me on.
So, did I get it right? Did you always have a interest in God and the movies, but a separate kind of interest in both?
Yeah. So, it was a long journey, obviously. And, you know, I went through a really dark time in my life and I started watching a ton of movies. I've always had a love for movies. I love movies. And I just started watching all these movies during this really dark time in my life. And I felt like God was speaking to me through those movies. So I just started writing. And honestly, it was just like a grief journal because I had gone through a lot of loss, a lot of pain in my life. And I just started writing. And then all of a sudden, it came up for me to create a book. And it all of a sudden just became a book and then made it into like Barnes & Noble stores and, you know, all this stuff. I've been on signings. I've gotten to meet like some crazy people that I never thought I would ever meet. And yeah, it's been crazy. It's been an interesting journey for sure. So
has there been any negative part to it? Because as I mentioned in the opening, reading just the title, if I were to walk past that with my wife, she would be like, "Ah, oh, somebody's using the name of Jesus to sell someone." My wife is a very devout Christian, by the way. But she would be upset just at the title. Also, look, somebody's using Jesus to sell books about movies. So has there been any of that visceral, knee-jerk reaction to just the title?
Yeah, before I answer that question, I just want to give a shout-out to all you guys in chat. I appreciate you guys. This is some of my Twitch fam. You know, we hang out on Twitch and all that, on playing games and stuff. But you guys are awesome. Thanks for coming out. But yeah, so I took a trip down to Georgia. I was doing three signings in 3 days at three different Barnes & Noble stores. And Georgia is, you know, a pretty conservative area. So there were people that were incredibly intrigued by the book. It actually sold out twice on the 2 days. The third day, I actually had to leave early. I had to come back home. But the first day, I was standing there, there was this guy, he had said, you know, he was a Christian, you know, he looked at the book, and there were horror movies. There are horror movies in this book. And for me personally, I connect very deeply with horror movies because there's a trauma, that you're able to reach if you, experience horror and, you know, you experience traumatic things in your life. And I believe horror movies, that's like one of the greatest avenues to express that. So that's why I wrote about horror movies. But there were a couple of those encounters. I'll be completely honest with you. They picked up the book, they saw horror movies, and they're just like, no way. Horror cannot exist in this. But wow. I come back with saying, no, I totally believe that, you know, God can speak through anything. I mean, yeah. So I can go on about a couple of those things, but
yeah. I would be happy to let you go on. I just want to make a kind of off the subject comment here. Somebody in the chat room, I guess one of your Twitch buddies, said something about it. I love his mustache. People write about my mustache more about than they write about anything else I do. And I kind of laugh about that because it's kind of funny. But somebody, one of my testimonials from a guest who was on last week, it wrote a classic one that I had my social media following kind of just goofing on me all week about the mustache, and I'm wondering if maybe somebody read that or it's just an independent observation. But thanks for commenting on my mustache. So were you active in writing all your life, or a blogger, or any of that kind of stuff, or not at all?
I can tell you that when I would have rough days at school or, you know, anything like that, whether it was middle school, high school, I went to my room, locked myself in my room, and just escaped by writing. I did a lot of writing. Actually, before we got married, I was packing up all my stuff and I saw that I had about 7 journals filled to the brim just with writing, and just writing random things, writing things I was dealing with, all this stuff. I'm just like, wow. So I have gone to writing. I've gone to writing for the grieving process, for a lot of what I've been through. And ultimately that is what this book came from. I was never a good student in school. I tried really hard. Probably when I was like in 11th grade, 12th grade, my senior year, that was when I was like understanding on how to be a student, you know, and all that. But I was never the best writer, nothing like that. So, but yeah, writing has been therapy for me, basically.
Excellent. So I looked at the samplings of the book and got an idea for what's going on. And it's interesting that you mentioned horror, because I've had probably 10 horror directors on in the last couple of months, and they all have kind of a spiritual side to them, and this belief, you know, and it's one thing I talk about often on this program is the real basic conflict in human nature, which is good versus evil. And I think that's probably what you pick up on and what attracts you. And I don't want to put words in your mouth or anything, but the idea that in these horror movies, horror stories, horror literature, you're going to find this classic battle between good and evil. And it sounds to me like that's where you got your interest in horror movies. Am I correct in that?
So I always go back to, even the horror director, one of the horror directors that I really look up to is Scott Derrickson. He directed Sinister, he directed Exorcism of Emily Rose. He even directed Doctor Strange. He had said, and he had always gone back to when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and all of his friends betrayed him, and he was literally sweating blood, like drops of blood were coming from his face. He was sweating so much because he had so much anxiety, he had so much stress, so much trauma over what he was about to go through. He's literally about to carry the entire world on his shoulders, and all of his friends left him. And like the father was turning his face away. So literally, if you're talking about like one of the most horrific moments, like I connected so much with that, and I feel like horror movies are able to enter that space. Does that make sense? Mm.
Yeah, sure. So each chat, I don't know if it's broken up this way from the sampling, it's a little difficult to tell, but it seems like each chapter is about a specific movie and it's preceded by a Bible verse. Mm-hmm. And you tie that, the message from that Bible verse, into what you got out of that film.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So explain a little, and let's take a walk through that. I believe there's 30 films in the book.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about that, if you will. Like, sure. Toy Story is the first one that I saw struck me as an odd place to start an exploration of God in movies through that movie. So, mm-hmm. Tell me what about that movie kind of piqued your interest?
So, there's a lot in that movie. There's a lot to unpack for sure, and there's a lot to unpack in all of these movies. A lot of these movies, these were messages that just spoke to me, honestly, and they've been speaking to people, and it's been crazy. But Toy Story, Woody gets rejected by Andy, basically, gets replaced by Buzz. How many of us have ever been rejected? How many of us have ever felt replaced, left alone? And kind of transitioning into that and saying, you know, God wants to be your friend always. God will never leave you. And yeah, God is like the ultimate Andy, you know, and wants to hang out with you all the time. So,
right. Yeah. I asked about, you know, bad feedback on the book just from people who kind of just took the wrong first impression from it. Have you gotten some really good feedback about people who said, thank you, this has really opened my mind to faith in a new way that I never had before?
Yeah, it's been absolutely insane. I mean, honestly, my goal was just, if this book impacts one person, then I've done my mission. You know what I'm saying? But the fact that it's been impacting, you know, several people, it's been really crazy. I've gotten emails, messages from people, even, you know, a message from somebody who had said that they feel like God connects with them in horror movies as well. So that was really nice to hear that. But yeah, a lot of stories. So
I'm one of these people who will never watch a horror movie, only because it's not like I think they're evil or any of that stuff, because I know in almost every single one, good triumphs in the end, right? Or at least when I used to watch them when I was a kid, they just give me nightmares. And I especially psychological thriller, because I know there's a lot of different subgenres in horror, and that idea of, you know, the ones that really get in your mind and make you think about it for weeks after, and those can haunt you and really stick with you. I'm guessing you have a different experience in that somehow you find a way to keep the good message that you got from that alive for a couple of weeks. Where me, I'll be haunted by just the scariest notions and not be able to sleep for a week. Yeah. Explain to me how you deal with that and reconcile that.
Of course. I mean, first and foremost, looking at film as an art form and realizing that it's a creative thing created by people. Being creative. I know a lot of creativity words there, but it's super creative, and respecting it as an art as well. But the second thing, and probably the most important thing to me, is that horror really connects with me personally. Connects with me personally because I've been through some very traumatic stuff. And with those traumatic things, I get reminders. I get reminders of what had happened to me. You know, whether it's on a daily occurrence or, you know, yeah. So it's me dealing with that and dealing and facing the fear of that, and, you know, kind of looking at it in that way, if that makes sense.
My life is pretty much an open book doing this podcast stuff. So when you talk about trauma, I talk about my personal life a lot and open up to people on this podcast. And lately, I mean, 3 out of the 5 episodes before tonight, people had mentioned to me on air, I know about all the stuff that you went through with your father, and I think, and basically painting me as a victim, which I never wanted to really. I was just explaining what I went through as part of the discussion about whatever topic we happen to be talking about. But it's funny, and I started getting email about, you know, poor you with the stuff that you went through with your father, and if people want to rehash it, there's plenty of podcasts you can go listen to and find out all. I'm not being elusive on purpose here, just out of time, necessity and time. I don't want to retell those stories. But I think a lot of us have gone through trauma and that kind of stuff. And I think being an open book about it, at least in my case, helps to alleviate some of the pain and help you move past it. Do you share that, you know, publicly, the kind of stuff you went through or not?
Yeah, I have pretty recently. You know, I haven't really revealed every single thing that I've been through, particularly because it's kind of personal. But basically what had happened to me is pretty much like the example of Jesus, and, you know, all of his friends left him, and they just left him to kind of die. So if you can, you know, something around those lines, you know, it's not necessarily like to that intense aspect. It's just more like I felt like I belonged and I was in a specific place.
Right.
And to have all of that taken from you I mean, the perfect example is I wrote about it, The Count of Monte Cristo. I don't know if you've ever seen that movie, The Count of Monte Cristo.
Sure, of course.
Yeah, you know,
it was mandatory watching when I was in school 100 years ago.
and the 2002 version, you know, I don't know if you've seen that one with Jim.
Oh, no, I haven't.
So that's a really good one. It paints a really big picture of what happened there. And, you know, Edmund had gone through so much rejection, but he had gone through so much abandonment because of what had happened to him. He was living a perfect life. And then his best friend betrays him, sends him to prison. He's alone, you know, all this stuff. And he tries to take revenge on all those people that did him wrong. But in the end, you know, he realizes that it was for nothing. And, right. You know, so there's, yeah. So
that's interesting. So you bring up a couple of things there that I kind of want to touch on now. Mm-hmm. First of all, were you a person of strong faith all your life or not?
Yeah. So when I was about 16, 17 years old, you know, I had an experience where, you know, I really felt like, you know, I sensed that God loved me and that, you know, I wasn't alone. And that's pretty much when it started, just around like 16, 17 years old. And then it's been continually growing. You know, I went to college, dealt with a lot of my junk, you know, in my life. You know, right. I had like a lot of stuff that I needed to deal with. And, you know, I was really thankful for the college I went to. The woman I met, you know, my wife, she's wonderful. She was literally a mirror for me, realizing that I needed to work on a lot of things. And so she's amazing. And it's just been a journey of growth, honestly. So.
You mentioned betrayal, and betrayal never really the thing about betrayal is it never comes from an enemy. Mm-hmm. it always comes from somebody you love a lot, you mm-hmm. trust a lot. Your enemies don't betray you. They're always your enemies, but it's your friends who end up betraying you. And I've had that experience in my life, and I can tell you, it is demoralizing in a lot of ways, and in a lot of ways mm-hmm. confusing. So is that what brought you to your love for God, or was your love for God there as a crutch to help you sustain yourself and maintain yourself through that feeling of betrayal?
Yeah. So when I was 16, 17, I didn't really experience, much of what, you know, we're talking about in terms of that, that sort of betrayal happened later on in my life, which was about, 3 years ago. So right now I'm 27. So I was like, when I was 23, that was when that happened. And that was when the seed was planted. And that was when, you know, I started writing the book. But yeah, so that explains.
What about, you mentioned video games, and I want to talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, for sure.
First of all, I think when people kind of are open about their faith, sometimes pushes people out of their lives. And I know from experience in just some of my family people that got involved in video games, they tend to be not so much open to faith, religion, any of that stuff. And so have you lost friends because you've been so openly open about your faith and your love for God?
No, I've had the same friends. I think, you know, when you have a, you know, relationship with friends, genuine friends, they stick with you, and they've stuck with me through it all. They've been my friends since like middle school, well, high school. And they're just awesome people. But yeah, I can understand what you're saying though. I can understand what you're saying.
So are you finding, because it's a natural evolution, I guess, where you've looked for it in movies, are you finding evidence of God's message in video games?
Sure.
And if so, how so?
Yeah, sure.
tell me a little bit about it.
You know, I really am. And a lot of what goes on in video games, there's a lot of toxicity. There's a lot of toxicity and negativity amongst, if you're playing PvP, which is player versus player. Right. It's basically you're playing a competitive sport. You're playing a sport if you're playing a competitive video game. And a lot of times people look at the player before they look at the person that they're playing with, and they bully them and they, you know, talk about all these things. So I think it's important to look at the player, but it's also super important to look at the person first, because it's about people. This is all about people. So.
People are saying stuff in the chat room, and I'm not sure because I'm an old man and I don't know what half of this stuff means. if you see, what is dab?
They want to dab.
Oh, okay.
The dab. Yeah.
I've never played a video game in my life. Yeah. I mean, that's not true. I played Super Mario Brothers when my son was a child, was very small, but on an old Nintendo machine. That's the kind of stuff I played, but I haven't played since then, so I don't know anything about it. And so do you have plans on writing another book? Because this one has been successful for you. Are you inspired to kind of follow that path and do another one in music, finding God in music, finding God in video games, whatever it is?
You know, a lot of people have asked me that. A lot of people have said, when's the second one coming out? All that stuff. Are you going to write about this? Are you going to write about your story? All that stuff. Honestly, this was just something that I needed to write, that I had to write. And I don't know that I necessarily have that urge to need to write something right now. But this was something that I literally needed to get on paper, and it came out and became a book and, you know, all that stuff. I really just care about impacting people's lives. I don't really care about anything else, but, it's been quite a journey. I really can't explain how I've been able to, you know, meet these people or, you know, just some of the feedback that I've gotten. So it's pretty insane, but it's been awesome. So
has it been humbling also?
Yeah, it's been super humbling. And, you know, just realizing more and more that I just care about people. And, you know, I honestly, that the fact that this helped people, I'm just like blown away.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And thank you. I think a lot of this idea of humility can be a sign of strength, and being humble can be a sign of strength. I think that gets lost. And that's kind of where I was going with that opening on that whole idea of taking a knee. And I know I don't want to get political here, but the idea behind kneeling is an act of humility. And so I think people just want to be angry and look for the wrong things in life sometimes, and don't understand. They think humility or being humble is a sign of weakness. You are obviously you have a tribe of supporters there who are holding you up and got your back. But it seems to me you're a very strong person, even though you've just talked about being humble. You want to address that a little bit?
Yeah, sure. I think society has pointed men as being super strong and pulling up your bootstraps, just moving forward, not admitting you're wrong. But I think being a man in today's culture, you have to admit that if you're wrong, you have to admit you're wrong. You have to apologize. You have to forgive, and you have to move forward. And honestly, those are the things that, you know, make a lot of sense. And honestly, love. You know,
there you go.
Let's love everyone. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I do know what you're saying. And I think that's a lost thing right now with everything that's going on in the world. Do you consider yourself an optimist?
Yeah, I do. I do normally consider myself an optimist. You know, I try to find the good in, you know, all situations. I really do. Yeah,
it's kind of hard for somebody in my position. I'm older. I'm 61 years old, and it's hard for me to understand what it must be like to be a young person in the world that we're living in right now, because this is the strangest time I've ever seen in my 61 years. And I often think what it's like to be a young person in today's world. And I don't think, and I could be wrong about this, but I don't think a lot of young people have much faith at all. Or if they do, it's not really pronounced or talked about as much. What's your take on that? Educate me a little bit on that, on the, I don't even know what they call your generation. I'm sick of those labels, the Generation X, Millennials, and all that stuff. Yeah, as a 27-year-old man in today's world, what's the outlook? And that the idea of faith among your generation, is are you a rarity?
I'm just a person. I'm just a dude. I love people, and I think, honestly, being genuine, being real with yourself, being real with others, loving others, that's probably, you know, the best advice I would ever give, if that makes sense. Trying to follow off your question, but yeah.
Yeah, but no, just how it is to be in this world. And you said you were an optimist, but, you know, the world was never this crazy when I was young. And it was difficult to be an optimist when I was 27. I can't imagine being 27 and looking at, you know, not just all the political crap that's going on in the world right now, but all the nastiness and the, you know, the way people treat each other and all that kind of stuff. And then you look at, you know, the impact of what we're doing to the planet we live on and all that stuff. And I do think, you know, religion and faith have kind of taken a back seat in a lot of people's lives and get lost. So I just wonder about that whole experience. Do you find that a lot of people your age are, I don't want to call church goers, because you don't have to go to church to be a person of strong faith, I believe. But are young people generally of strong faith these days?
Yeah, I mean, I have tons of friends, you know, that you know, participate in, you know, faith and, you know, believe in God and, you know, all that stuff. I think ultimately what it comes down to is having a friend and knowing that there is an ultimate friend out there for you, and, you know, realizing that, yes, this world is a dark place. This world has a lot of darkness, but you can be a light and you can shine amongst the darkness. So,
wow, that's a great message. Thank you for that. And, you know, I think you're, you know, you say you're just a dude. You're not just a dude. You're an exceptional young man. In my view, I don't, you know, I talk to a lot of people. I had a 17-year-old evolutionary biologist on last week, and he was lecturing me on atheism and all that kind of. He's an atheist at this point in his life, but I asked him a little bit about the idea that does creationism and evolutionary science, are they necessarily exclusive? And he kind of hemmed and hawed a little bit, but he had to come back to the point, no, they are not necessarily exclusive. And my point was, yes, evolution can be happening. We can see evolution in species, but that doesn't mean God didn't create the species and it's all part of his plan. Because if you look at how evolution works, and this is where he really got caught up, I said, you would agree that evolution looks like it was an intelligently designed process because of the way things work out, where one species is dependent on this behavior of another species, and it goes through to a different species. In other words, a giraffe can with its long neck can pull up the fruit, but the birds that eat off the giraffe dung also thrive because of that process that seemed like a design. And he had to come back to, yes, the results of evolution definitely point to extraordinary results that you wouldn't expect if there weren't an intelligent design behind, which I thought was a big concession from a guy who just 2 minutes before was telling me he was an atheist and believed in that the, you know, in man's just temporary existence and there was nothing further than this. So your thoughts on that stuff, on the kind of, do you ever get involved in those heavy theological discussions and the ideas behind linking science with faith?
Yeah, science is awesome. I love science. Science is amazing. I went to a you know, Christian college, and there was this professor, and he was an evolutionary biologist, and he believed in God and he believed in evolution. And I've met plenty of people that are for evolution and are for God. I met plenty of people that don't believe in evolution and believe in God. And I met a whole bunch of different slews of people. Ultimately, what you're saying is that, yeah, it's true. It comes down to, all right, who did it all? You know what I'm saying? I think that's where it comes from.
So, and can evolution be true even though there is a creator or a natural? And I always say I'm not smart enough. I've never been smart enough to know the true nature of God. But I have to believe that science is getting closer to proving the existence of at least as some form of God or creator behind it all, because everything works too seamlessly It seems, and as the young man said, it produces extraordinary results, is what he said, that you wouldn't expect without an intelligent designer. So I love that. I love that whole discussion. And I love that kind of bridging of science and religion, because I don't think they have to be necessarily exclusive. So do have any movies come out? Cause I know the book came out in 2018, almost 2 years ago. Have any movies come out that have inspired you since then that really have given you pause for thought?
Yeah, a lot. Honestly, a lot of movies have come out, obviously. I love movies, and movies speak to me all the time. You know, this was, I feel like, a baseline for me to really just unveil all that stuff that was, you know, in me just to let out.
Right.
But yeah, there's so many movies that have spoken to me. I'm literally, my mind is running like a treadmill on like the fastest speed right now, thinking about all these movies. But I recently watched Sonic the Hedgehog. There was a lot of you know, Sonic wanted to belong. He wanted to be friends he wanted a best friend, and he also wanted to live his best life. And I don't know. There's a lot of movies.
That's interesting. You know, it's weird. I don't even know what it was, but a half hour before the showtime, I was on Twitter and somebody was talking about Sonic the Hedgehog movie. And I was like, I don't know anything about this movie, but I forget what it was even about, but now I got to go back after the show and kind of check that out and what he was talking about. I'm so culturally unhip. I don't even know what movies are playing.
Oh, no.
I basically wait until stuff is on Netflix or Amazon Prime. And then it's got to be really suggested to me, and somebody will have to tell me that it's something you really should watch. It's something I know you could relate to before I'll even kind of waste my time with it. So I've been so separated from what's culturally hip. And I saw somebody in the chat room talking about, well, I guess they were older too. They said there wasn't as much social media when they were 27. When I was 27, social media was just hanging out with your friends on a Saturday night. So I think that plays into it. So do you have a heavy presence on social media, or are you spending a lot of time on video games?
I'm on Twitch. I've been on Twitch a lot lately. But it's been awesome. It's been really fun.
Tell me about Twitch, buddy, because I need to learn about Twitch, because I've been on there and I can't figure out. I know people stream like me, and I tried streaming this show on there. I know this. Yeah, I know this show is not for the Twitch crowd. But how do people are making money on Twitch? I know friends of mine who have Twitch streaming stuff. Is it just games? Is it gaming stuff, or are there streaming shows and stuff like that?
It's anything you want it to be.
How do people monetize it?
So I don't, again, like, I don't care about that. I just care about impacting people's lives. You know what I'm saying? And that's just what I'm about. But it's awesome. It's live streaming. It's gaming. It's all that type of stuff. It's pretty much what you're doing right now, or what we're doing right now on YouTube.
They do talk shows, because I tried it, and I've gotten no, but I haven't put in a lot of effort in it. I just, you know, turn on the button and it goes live to Twitch, I don't get much there at all.
So you would be IRL, which is in real life. That's the category that you would do, because, you know, you're a talk show type of thing. So that's the category you would be in. And you just have fun. And there's people chatting and
interesting. You mind if I ask what you actually do besides writing for a living? What do you do?
Yeah, so I taught a little bit. I was an interim teacher, so I did that. I did a whole bunch of jobs as well. Worked at restaurants. Did all that stuff. But yeah, I've been doing the whole writing thing, and the book has been crazy. Going to Georgia and doing all that stuff. So it's been crazy.
Yeah. Well, the reason I had to ask was because you said you don't care about that. You just want to care about impacting lives. I think everybody cares about money at some point,
right?
Unless you're Jesus, you really have to in some way.
Right.
And it impacts everybody's lives, unfortunately. And I've done a lot of shows about money recently, and I'm the least. I don't understand money. I don't understand wealth. I don't understand finances. You would think I would after all these years, but It's one of those subjects that I never really cared about. I've been really irresponsible in that nature in my life. I've been an entertainer and a creator my entire life.
Yeah, I've seen your music stuff, man.
Yeah, I've done music, film. It's amazing. You know, thank you. Where'd you see it?
Yeah, it's not on YouTube. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Thank you. So that's the kind of stuff I do. So I never really, you know, as a creator, and I think most creative people, they kind of have this compartmentalized where I create art, let somebody else worry about the money kind of stuff and where it's coming from. And so as a person, I've been really irresponsible with money. Mm. But I love your attitude. I just care about impacting lives. But how do you measure that?
How do I measure that? You know, it's honestly, like I said, you know, with this book just impacting one person and the fact that it has impacted more than one person, I'm just like absolutely blown away. So the emails, the people sending me letters, it's literally been insane.
Do you use your voice that you have for this subject and the passion that you have for this mm-hmm. subject?
Yeah.
On Twitch when you're kind of engaging with these people, yes, you do.
Sure, yeah.
Really,
I would. It's a ton of fun.
Can people watch this as a voyeur? Like, tune in and be a fly on the wall to watching these games and the interaction between gamers.
Yeah, so basically what would happen was I would just be playing video games. There would be the face cam type of thing, and then there would be, a chat, and people can join in, you know, if I allow that or whatever. But, it's
interesting. Yeah. And so you're actually having a conversation while you're trying to beat somebody, and it's all thumbs and that kind of stuff.
Kind of, yeah.
How are your hands?
Yeah, you know, it's a bit of a workout.
I have carpal tunnel really bad.
Oh man, yeah.
3 years of playing guitar, I have nerve damage in one hand.
Oh no!
But I can just
imagine this guy, the legend right here. Legend.
Well, that's why I think probably I've stayed away from video games. Is that this kind of action stuff? It just it makes no sense to me.
I completely understand. Yeah.
Were you big on the games you play? Are they sports oriented? Like,
it's honestly one game that I play. It's called Apex Legends, and it's just a ton of fun. So,
what is it?
Oh, yeah, it's like a competitive shooter. Basically, you have a squad of, you know, either two people or one person on your team. It's a whole bunch of legends. I love Mirage. He's my guy, and I relate to him. Yeah. And you play
competitive against shooting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
what kind of gun is it? All like a shotgun, or is it like a 30-06? What is it?
It's created by this development team called Respawn, and they created their own, you know, weapons and, you know, play style and stuff. And the legends have unique abilities, so it's a lot of fun. You know, you get to play as the legend that you like, and it's pretty much that's it. My account is fill that in. So all these guys, we hang out and we have fun.
There you go. I'm going to have to read all these comments after the show's over, because there's a lot. We don't usually, I think obviously you're a very popular guy and you have some influence over people, because wow, I'm looking through all and you have quite a few friends here tonight. Say hello to Dr. Phoenix and Drax Twitch. Drops Twitch and Evan Blair. Hello, thank you for coming in and being part of this program. If anybody has a specific question they would like to hear Phil address, please just drop it in there. I don't know if I can catch them because some of the chat goes by so fast, you don't really see it all. But I want to thank everybody for coming in and helping us out here tonight and being part of this. What would you like people to take away from this discussion we've had for about 45 minutes now?
Yeah. I wrote a book during a really dark time in my life. And when you're going through a really difficult time in your life, you're going through anything, use the best medium to deal with it, whether it's writing, whether it's songs, drawing, anything that helps you get it out. You know, and that's what I did. I wrote Jesus Loves Movies, and the fact that it's been helping people, it's like crazy.
Right. Yeah. I would publish some testimonials on that because I think people need to hear stories that kind of give them license to be helped as well. What I mean by that is, so if I read a testimonial about somebody who your book may have helped them get through a tough time, I read that and then I think, well, maybe there's something in that for me, and I don't have to reject what I was necessarily, because some people often reject their feelings. Say, okay, this can't be real. I'm feeling like I'm seeing a little bit of light here, but it must be just my imagination, or I'm, you know, poo-poo it or whatever, and ignore it. I think seeing some testimonials about that stuff helps people say, well, I'm not alone in this. There are other people like me. So I would encourage you to do that and get
thanks. I appreciate that.
Yeah. And there's no plans for a second book. So what are you do you have any long term goals for your life? When you get old like me, where would you like to be?
Wow, that is such an itch. I mean, I ask myself, what am I doing in the next 5 seconds? I'm grabbing this water bottle to drink.
Right. You know, I've lived my life pretty much that way too, and I can understand it. But when you get to this age, and this has been a godsend for me, is realizing purpose. I went through life, you know, and I was being interviewed by an English guy today for a BBC interview, and he asked me about, you know, my midlife crisis. The show was about midlife crisis, and then this point where people where they feel burnt out, and they feel like their life had no meaning. They get to this point in their life, in middle age, and they feel like, you know, what am I doing? What have I lived for? What was the reason I was even born? What the hell was my life about? And that your midlife crisis happens to a lot of people. And it's happened to me at 20 and 30 and then 40 and then 50. And at six, by the time I got to 60, I don't feel like I'm aging is a problem anymore. I feel like, you know, I'm happy that I've survived this long. I never expected to. But the big thing for me, the big takeaway is purpose, having a purpose. And if there are young people in the audience, I find, you know, and bringing it back to God, if you believe that you were born, God gave you a purpose for your life. It wasn't just to be here and punch a clock for 40 hours or a week and go home and have kids and then hope that they live out whatever dream you had for your life or your ambitions. And so, you know, that's a big part of it, having purpose. And I understand that. I'm only thinking about what's happening in the next 5 seconds, and I'm going to grab the thing and have a drink. I understand where you're coming from. That was me my whole life. Yeah. But you don't have any kind of long-term dream that you would like to fulfill or any of that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question to ask. There's a lot of dreams that, you know, I feel like I do have that I do want to do. I want to do so many things. You know, open up a food truck, or, you know, I want to open up a small cafe, or, you know, something along those lines. I don't know. There's like a lot of things, and a lot of what I go back to is like, nothing is impossible. And I want to live this life, you know, to the full, you know. Well,
I want to get to Dr. Phoenix's question in a second. Okay, no problem. But I don't want to get there just yet, because I want to tell you this along the lines of what you just said, that, you know, nothing is impossible. This is a story I tell people, who, the creative people, all the time. And it leads to a question about that life's purpose. As you know, I'm a musician, and I was buying a amp off a guy on Craigslist. He had an amplifier, and so I called him up, and he wanted to meet me in a mall parking lot. And I thought, man, that's strange. It's an amplifier. I need to plug it in. But okay, I'll meet you in a mall parking lot. But in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, that's just weird. Why does he want me to meet him in this mall parking lot? I get there before him purposely, and he pulls up in a very expensive vehicle. He's got a watch on. I notice right away that the band is covered in diamonds. His wife is with him. He's covered in diamonds and pearls. They both smell like beautiful people. They just smell great. And I said, wow, these people have got some money. You know, that was the first thought in my mind. They're well off. They're pretty people. And so we got to talking, and he said, what do you do? I said, I play in a band. And he said, oh, you're living the dream. And I laughed in his face hard. And I didn't do it to be rude. It was just a natural reaction. I said to them, listen, man, I'm not a rock star. I'm not rich and famous. I play parties. I play beaches. I play bars. This is my life. And he stopped me. He said, you don't understand. I'm 69 years old. I'm retiring. I'm selling you my amp. I always wanted to be in a band. Now I'm selling you my amp. I'm never going to be in a band. That's what it means for me. You're living my dream. And I went, whoa, that's a perspective thing. I never really looked at my life through somebody else's eyes and somebody else's shoes and say, wow. what does life mean to me? So it changed my perception of myself and what I was doing and my purpose in life. Mm. And it also made me want to create a film of my own and called Rockin' the Dream. It's the idea is living the dream. My band is Rockin' 45. But it's about all creative people and about what it takes, the price it takes to live a dream and all the stuff you have to go through, the sacrifices you have to make. Sometimes you have to lose friends. Sometimes you have to work three jobs to support your dream, all that kind of stuff. So, but that doesn't happen without purpose. But as you mentioned, you know, nothing is impossible. So I take that, you know, when you said that, I thought, well, this guy's 69 years old. He's conceding that it's impossible, that he can never do what he really wanted to do. But the worst thing about life is if you get to the end of your life, you're on your deathbed, the worst thing you can say is, I wish I had tried. I wish I had done this with my life. So that's what having purpose is all about, which is why I ask you a question. Do you have it? And I try to inspire young people to find a purpose.
Yeah, no regrets.
Well, yeah. I think you mentioned your purpose, and we overlooked it. We both overlooked it. Your purpose is impacting people's lives. You said it. You said it three times or four times already. So I would say that's it. You just don't know the method that you're going to be using for that for the rest of your life. Would you agree?
Yeah, I mean that encourages me a lot. You know, you're a super wise. You just sound like a wise guru. So you know, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, so. Dr. Phoenix, is he a real doctor? Is he really from Phoenix? I got a question. Do you think video games promote violence or bad behavior?
For me?
Yeah, that's...
Yeah,
you do?
Oh, no. Whoa. Oh. I get that's... So there are a lot of sides to that. You're constantly fueling your... You could constantly fuel your mind with all of these things. They have all these statistics and everything. That's a really good question. I don't think it promotes violence or bad behavior, but it also depends on what you're playing. But I don't know. I don't think that it promotes violence or bad behavior because, you know, I play Apex Legends. It's a shooting game. You know, people, little kids, they play Fortnite, a shooting game. And, you know, you gotta be grounded in your conscience. And you gotta know that this is not like the right thing. It's just a video game. You're just having fun playing a game. So,
well, as an old geezer who's never played a video game, I have a lot of friends my age who want to make that argument that when we see a school shooting perhaps or something something along that line, they want to associate it with video games. And I disagree, because the overwhelming number of people you know who play video games who don't go out and shoot up a school outweighs that one person. Mm-hmm. So to me, it's about the individual. And you to bring it back to where we started, horror films had the same when I was growing up. That was the story, you know, you watch horror films and that's what's triggering the acts of violence and stuff. It's about the individual and what they, the qualities they, and the values and principles they hold. Do you agree with that?
Yeah. I mean, it's the same kind of, it reminds me of the same kind of argument that you were saying, you know, in regards to, oh, you're listening to this type of rock and roll music, or you're listening or watching these rated R movies, or, you know, anything along those lines. And you're acting in that certain way because you're feeding your brain that, but you know, there's things that you could just watch and it's just a movie, you know? So.
Wow. We've got so much in action in the chat room tonight. I lost my links to your book where people can get it, but I'm going to pull it back up and just,
yeah, you're fine. Don't worry about it.
It's just funny that, you know, that usually doesn't happen where we run out of room in the chat room. So here I'm putting it up right here and there it is. Cool. Jesus Loves Movies is his website, and then the Amazon link I will put, and all these links will be actually in the description, so it'll be nice and clickable. Great. You can find it. I think people would be wise to just check out the, at least check out the sampling on Amazon and see if the book is for you, because I was fascinated by the two short samples that were on there, the way you tied some scripture into movies that I hadn't even thought that would have any references to God or faith or Jesus or any of that stuff in it, and you found a way to kind of get a positive message out of it. So I think you're unique. You have a unique gift and a unique way of looking at stuff. And I know it's hard to hear compliments like that sometimes, but I want to tell you that I think you're an extraordinary young man.
I really, really appreciate that. I mean, you're awesome too, man. It's great to be here. And like I said, you're a super wise dude. So
well, thank you. And thank you for coming tonight. I hope, I wish you great success with the book. And please, you know, if things start happening in your life, there's anything you want to kind of promote, or you got another book, and I know that's not in the plans, but you never know. Whatever direction your life takes, if you want to help promote it, feel free to come back, you know, just drop me a line and say, sure, can I come on and just talk about this? And I'd love to have you back. I think you're an extraordinary example of how we want our young people to be and grow up and become young adults. So thank you for your insights and your time tonight. And I wish you all the success in the world.
Thank you so much, Matt. I hope you have a fantastic night.
Thanks for coming. Have a great night.
All right.
Bye for now. Phil Strangolagalli. I'm still mad at him for having that last name. You know, I usually struggle with names that are, people from different countries when I have them on. Not so much with Americans, but I practiced his name several times, and I did it right in a row, and then still struggled with it. So I'm mad at myself for that, and I apologize to him for that kind of mess up. I hope you enjoyed this program tonight. I hope you tell your friends about it and come back. I hope if you're on Twitch and you see me on there, you'll tune in and say, hey, that's the guy that had Phil on there. Let's check him out. Because we do have a variety of topics on here. I do focus a lot on comedians on the evening hours. So comedians, filmmakers, and I think, you know, Phil being a film buff, and I'm sure some of his friends and associates sure are probably film buffs as well. We have a lot of filmmakers on, a lot of actors. So if you enjoyed this program, please come back, tell your friends about it. Go to my YouTube channel, subscribe there to find out, you know, get reminders and find out what we're posting daily. Go to minddogtv.com, get on my mailing list there. If you have questions or comments you would like to offer, please info@minddogtv.com. That's info@minddogtv.com. Till Sunday night. I'm taking a night off tomorrow. Believe it or not, I'm taking a whole day off. Not really off, not having a show. I'll be working on other things behind the scenes. But Sunday night, Jeff Burns, Jeff Twitch Burns, by the way, that's his nickname. He's the gangster patriot. He is a guy who's a former counterterrorism expert, working with the DEA and several government agencies as a counterterrorist expert, and battled the Taliban and ISIS abroad and things like that. But he also is an outlaw biker club expert at being part of Hell's Angels and the Pagans and all that kind of stuff. He's got a new book out called Gangster Patriot. We're going to talk to him about that at 8 p.m. Sunday night. So till then, I'm Matt Napo for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thank you for coming. And